Harper Audio presents The Harlequin Tea Set and Other Stories by Agatha Christie, performed by Hugh Fraser, Isla Blair, and Simon Vance.
The Edge. Claire Halliwell walked down the short path that led from her cottage door to the gate. On her arm was a basket, and in the basket was a bottle of soup, some homemade jelly, and a few grapes. There were not many poor people in the small village of Damer's End, but such as there were assiduously looked after, and Claire was one of the most efficient of the parish workers. Claire Halliwell was 32. She had an upright carriage, a healthy colour, and nice brown eyes. She was not beautiful, but she looked fresh and pleasant and very English. Everybody liked her and said she was a good sort. Since her mother's death 2 years ago, she'd lived alone in the cottage with her dog, Rover. She kept poultry and was fond of animals and of a healthy outdoor life. As she unlatched the gate, a two-seater car swept past, and the driver, a girl in a red hat, waved a greeting. Claire responded, but for a moment her lips tightened. She felt that pang at her heart which always came when she saw Vivian Lee, Gerald's wife. Medenham Grange, which lay just a mile outside the village, had belonged to the Lees for many generations. Sir Gerald Lee, the present owner of the Grange, was a man old for his years and considered by many stiff in manner. His pomposity really covered a good deal of shyness. He and Claire had played together as children. Later, they'd been friends, and a closer and dearer tie had been confidently expected by many, including, it may be said, Claire herself. There was no hurry, of course, but some day... She left it so in her own mind. Some day. And then, just a year ago, the village had been startled by the news of Sir Gerald's marriage to a Miss Harper, a girl nobody had ever heard of. The new Lady Lee had not been popular in the village. She took not the faintest interest in parochial matters, was bored by hunting, and loathed the country and outdoor sports. Many of the wiseacres shook their heads and wondered how it would end. It was easy to see where Sir Gerald's infatuation had come in. Vivian was a beauty. From head to foot, she was a complete contrast to Claire Halliwell. Small, elfin, dainty, with golden red hair that curled enchantingly over her pretty ears, and big violet eyes that could shoot a sideways glance of provocation to the manner born. Gerald Lee, in his simple man's way, had been anxious that his wife and Claire should be great friends. Claire was often asked to dine at the Grange, and Vivian made a pretty pretense of affectionate intimacy whenever they met. Hence that gay salutation of hers this morning. Claire walked on and did her errand. The vicar was also visiting the old woman in question, and he and Claire walked a few yards together afterwards, before their ways parted. They stood still for a minute, discussing parish affairs.
"Jones has broken out again, I'm afraid," said the vicar. "And I had such hopes after he had volunteered of his own accord to take the pledge."
"Disgusting," said Claire crisply.
"It seems so to us," said Mr. Wilmot. "But we must remember that it is very hard to put ourselves in his place and realise his temptation. The desire for drink is unaccountable to us, but we all have our own temptations, and thus we can understand."
"I suppose we have," said Claire uncertainly. The vicar glanced at her.
"Some of us have the good fortune to be very little tempted," he said gently. "But even to those people their hour comes. Watch and pray, remember, that ye enter not into temptation."
Then bidding her goodbye, he walked briskly away. Claire went on thoughtfully, and presently she almost bumped into Sir Gerald Lee.
"Oh, hello, Claire. I was hoping to run across you. You look jolly fit. What a colour you've got."
The colour had not been there a minute before. Lee went on,
"As I say, I was hoping to run across you. Vivian's got to go off to Bournemouth for the weekend. Her mother's not well. Can you dine with us Tuesday instead of tonight?"
"Oh, yes.
Tuesday will suit me just as well.
That's all right, then. Splendid. Must hurry along.
Claire went home to find her one faithful domestic standing on the doorstep, looking out for her.
Oh, there you are, miss. Such a to-do. They've brought Rover home. He went off on his own this morning and a car ran clean over him.
Claire hurried to the dog's side. She adored animals, and Rover was her especial darling. She felt his legs, one by one, and then ran her hands over his body. He groaned once or twice and licked her hand.
If there's any serious injury, it's internal, she said at last. No bones seem to be broken.
Shall we get the vet to see him, miss?
Claire shook her head. She had little faith in the local vet.
We'll wait until tomorrow.
He doesn't seem to be in great pain, and his gums are a good colour, so there can't be much internal bleeding. Tomorrow, if I don't like the look of him, I'll take him over to Skippington in the car and let Reeves have a look at him. He's far and away the best man. On the following day, Rover seemed weaker. Claire duly carried out her project. The small town of Skippington was about 40 miles away, a long run, but Reeves, the vet there, was celebrated for many miles round. He diagnosed certain internal injuries, but held out good hopes of recovery, and Claire went away quite content to leave Rover in his charge. There was only one hotel of any pretensions in Skippington, the County Arms. It was mainly frequented by commercial travellers, for there was no good hunting country near Skippington, and it was off the track of the main roads for motorists. Lunch was not served till 1 o'clock, and as it wanted a few minutes to that hour, Claire amused herself by glancing over the entries in the open visitor's book. Suddenly, she gave a stifled exclamation. Surely she knew that handwriting, with its loops and whirls and flourishes. She had always considered it unmistakable. Even now she could have sworn. But of course it was clearly impossible. Vivian Lee was in Bournemouth. The entry itself showed it to be impossible. Mr. and Mrs. Cyril Brown, London. But in spite of herself, her eyes strayed back again and again to that curly writing, and on an impulse, she could not quite define, she asked abruptly of the woman in the office, Mrs. Cyril Brown, I wonder if that is the same one I know. A small lady, reddish hair, very pretty. She came in a red two-seater, madam, a Peugeot, I believe. Then it was. A coincidence would be too remarkable. As if in a dream, she heard the woman go on, they were here just over a month ago for a weekend, and liked it so much, they've come again. Newly married, I fancy. Claire heard herself saying,
thank you. I don't think that could be my friend.
Her voice sounded different, as though it belonged to someone else. Presently, she was sitting in the dining room, quietly eating cold roast beef, her mind a maze of conflicting thoughts and emotions. She had no doubts whatever. She'd summed up Vivian pretty correctly on their first meeting. Vivian was that kind. She wondered vaguely who the man was. Someone Vivian had known before her marriage? Very likely. It didn't matter. Nothing mattered. But Gerald. But what was she, Claire, to do about Gerald? He ought to know. Surely he ought to know. It was clearly her duty to tell him. She had discovered Vivian's secret by accident, but she must lose no time in acquainting Gerald with the facts. She was Gerald's friend, not Vivian's. But somehow or other she felt uncomfortable. Her conscience was not satisfied. On the face of it, her reasoning was good, but duty and inclination jumped suspiciously together. She admitted to herself that she disliked Vivian. Besides, if Gerald Lee were to divorce his wife, and Claire had no doubts at all that that was exactly what he would do. He was a man with an almost fanatical view of his own honour. Then, well, the way would lie open for Gerald to come to her. Put like that, she shrank back fastidiously. Her own proposed action seemed naked and ugly. The personal element entered in too much. She could not be sure of her own motives. Claire was essentially a high-minded, conscientious woman. She strove now very earnestly to see where her duty lay. She wished, as she'd always wished, to do right.
What was right in this case? What was wrong? By a pure accident, she'd come into possession of facts that affected vitally the man she loved and the woman whom she disliked and, yes, one might as well be frank, of whom she was bitterly jealous. She could ruin that woman. Was she justified in doing so? Claire had always held herself aloof from the backbiting and scandal, which is an inevitable part of village life. She hated to feel that she now resembled one of those human ghouls she'd always professed to despise. Suddenly, the vicar's words that morning flashed across her mind. Even to those people, their hour comes. Was this her hour? Was this her temptation? Had it come insidiously disguised as a duty? She was Claire Halliwell, a Christian, in love and charity with all men and women. If she were to tell Gerald, she must be quite sure that only impersonal motives guided her. For the present, she would say nothing. She paid her bill for luncheon and drove away, feeling an indescribable lightening of spirit. Indeed, she felt happier than she'd done for a long time. She felt glad that she'd had the strength to resist temptation, to do nothing mean or unworthy. Just for a second, it flashed across her mind that it might be a sense of power that had so lightened her spirits. But she dismissed the idea as fantastic. By Tuesday night, she was strengthened in her resolve. The revelation would not come through her. She must keep silence. Her own secret love for Gerald made speech impossible. Rather a high-minded view to take? Perhaps. But it was the only one possible for her. She arrived at the Grange in her own little car. Sir Gerald's chauffeur was at the front door to drive it round to the garage after she'd alighted, as the night was a wet one. He'd just driven off when Claire remembered some books which she'd borrowed and had brought with her to return. She called out, but the man did not hear her. The butler ran out after the car. So, for a minute or two, Claire was alone in the hall, close to the door of the drawing room, which the butler had just unlatched prior to announcing her. Those inside the room, however, knew nothing of her arrival. And so it was that Vivian's voice, high-pitched, not quite the voice of a lady, rang out clearly and distinctly. "Oh, we're only waiting for Claire Halliwell. You must know her. Lives in the village. Supposed to be one of the local belles, but frightfully unattractive, really. She tried her best to catch Gerald, but he wasn't having any. Oh, yes, darling." This in answer to a muttered protest from her husband. "She did. You mayn't be aware of the fact, but she did her very utmost. Oh, poor old Claire. Good sort, but such a dump." Claire's face went dead white. Her hands, hanging against her sides, clenched themselves in anger such as she'd never known before. At that moment, she could have murdered Vivian Lee. It was only by a supreme physical effort that she regained control of herself. That, and the half-formed thought that she held it in her power to punish Vivian for those cruel words. The butler had returned with the books. He opened the door, announced her, and in another moment she was greeting a room full of people in her usual pleasant manner. Vivian, exquisitely dressed in some dark wine colour that showed off her white fragility, was particularly affectionate and gushing. They didn't see half enough of Claire. She, Vivian, was going to learn golf, and Claire must come out with her on the links. Gerald was very attentive and kind. Though he had no suspicion that she'd overheard his wife's words, he had some vague idea of making up for them. He was very fond of Claire, and he wished Vivian wouldn't say the things she did. He and Claire had been friends, nothing more. And if there was any uneasy suspicion at the back of his mind that he was shirking the truth in that last statement, he put it away from him. After dinner, the talk fell on dogs, and Claire recounted Rover's accident. She purposely waited for a lull in the conversation to say, "So, on Saturday, I took him to Skippington." She heard the sudden rattle of Vivian Lee's coffee cup on the saucer, but she did not look at her, yet. "See that man Reeves?" "Yes. He'll be all right, I think. I had lunch at the County Arms afterwards. Rather a decent little pub." She turned now to Vivian. "Have you ever stayed there?" If she'd had any doubts, they were swept aside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.